Easter service together.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you."
So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him."
After he said this, he showed them his hands and side.
The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord.
So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus's head. Finally, the other disciple also went inside. He saw and believed.
Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them,
"Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe."
Now Mary stood outside the tomb, crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. She turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?"
Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him and I will get him." Jesus said to her,
"Mary."
Mary.
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 A week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Jesus came and stood among them. Then he said to Thomas,
"Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side."
Stop doubting and believe.
Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news.
"I have seen the Lord."
Thomas said to them, "My Lord and my God."
And Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed.
Blessed are those who have not seen,
yet have believed."
Do you believe? And what do you believe? And what does it matter? So we're going to talk about today, and whether it's your first time or your first time in a long time, we want you to know that we are glad that you're here, whether you're present in the room or whether you're in the overflow. We just want to let you, can we just give it up for our friends in the overflow? Just those who are out there. Here's my prayer for all of us, no matter where you're sitting today, is that you'd have an encounter with God. That you'd have an encounter with a God who loves you and is in pursuit of you out of his love for you, that you would experience that today. And we're going to get into the conversation by talking about what happened at a garden tomb 2,000 years ago and what happened on the gridiron 5 months ago. And have you ever been around some people who believe something and you're like, "I don't know"? Like some people who believe something, you're like, "I'm not so sure." If you've ever felt that way, that's how I felt. Let me tell you a story. I need to introduce you to my family. If you're new, this is a picture of my family, my beautiful wife Ree, and our four amazing kids: Raleigh, Camden, Durham, and Bolton. They all have names of cities in North Carolina. That's another story for another day. You have to come back for that one. But Durham is our oldest son, and he plays football. He's a great player. He's bigger than me. I know that's hard to believe, but he's bigger than me. And he, great player. He's got some great young men that are on his team with, some great coaches. They struggled. They struggled to win, and had a couple really challenging seasons. Their record was 0-22, and so they had a great student section. And the student section, they had this cheer that they would do every game before the game. They began to chant, "I believe that we will win. Can we all just chant that together? I believe that we will win. I believe that we..." And they would chant that every game before the game, and things would get crazy. Things would get hyped. People would lose their mind, and then they would lose. And it was, and we loved these young men, loved the coaches, and it just, they struggled, and it's just... you know, it's heartbreaking. And they believed. They believed. And so think about it. What difference does it make to believe? What is belief? Well, let me give you a definition. If you're taking notes today, you can write this down. What you believe informs your mental map of how you see the world. What you believe is your mental map of how you see the world. And I know if you're anything like me, I want my mental map to line up with reality. What's reality? Reality is the way things really are. And so I know what is true, and I want that to inform my mental map. And we can just whittle it down to two primary assumptions that shape belief. One is that some believe that this is all just a cosmic accident and that we're all just a random collection of molecules. Another would believe that there is a creator, that there is an intentional designer, that there is an architect, that there is a God who made you on purpose and for a purpose. And what you believe about that matters. Even unbelief is a belief. Like, we all believe something. And your belief shapes your mental map of how you see the world. A.W. Tozer, a great author, theologian, he said this: whatever comes to mind when we think about God is the single most important thing about us, because it shapes how we see everything. It not just shapes how you see God, your theology, it shapes how you see yourself when you look at yourself in the mirror. It shapes how you see other people and how you treat other people. It shapes how you see your purpose and how you see meaning in life. It shapes how you see everything. Stephen Covey has a great illustration about this. He said, suppose that somebody gave you a map and said you need to go to Chicago and find a specific destination, and you didn't have your phone. Now, some of you, I lost you because you're not familiar. Maps, we used to use them back in the 1900s. They were... It's history. We would use. And so suppose somebody gave you a map of Chicago, but because of a printing error, instead of a map of Chicago on the inside, it says Chicago on the outside, but instead of a map of Chicago on the inside, it was a map of Detroit. Now, imagine how frustrating that would be, how confusing that would be. It wouldn't matter how fast you go. It wouldn't matter how good your attitude is. If you had an inaccurate map, there's no way you can find your destination. The same is true in life. I can't tell you how many people I've sat with at the end of life, and so much of their fear and their frustration and their grief and their regret came from living life from inaccurate maps about relationships, about purpose, about success, about money, about what happiness really is. And so the question today is, like, where'd you get your maps? What map are you trusting in for life? Because we all have a map. Maybe it's one we've pieced together from things in this world, from ideas in this world. But what map are you trusting in? And the reason Easter is such a celebration is because something happened 2,000 years ago that changed the map forever. It changed life forever. It changed the calendar. Every time you or I write the date, it points back to what happened 2,000 years ago. It changed history. It changes eternity. It changes the way that we see. It changes the way we see everything, the way we see life and death and meaning and purpose and sadness and joy and frustration and peace and truth and love and guilt and shame and faith and forgiveness and hope and eternity. It changes everything. What happened that first Easter changed the map forever. We're going to look at it together in John chapter 20. If you've got a Bible, you can turn there with me. John chapter 20, it's page 988 in my Bible. I have no idea what it is in yours, but 988, John chapter 20, look at it together. And if you're unfamiliar, the Bible is made up of two parts. It's the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament is written in Hebrew, and it tells the story of the relationship with God, the people of God. It gives the prophecies and the promises that all point to the Messiah, that all point to Jesus. The New Testament starts out with Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who are disciples or who are eyewitnesses of the account of Christ's life. It gives their account, their document of the life of Jesus and the ministry of Jesus. The one that we're looking at today, John, he was one of the 12 disciples, and he was one who followed Jesus for 3 years. Got to see signs, wonders, miracles. He heard the greatest teaching that the world has ever heard. And he documents this account in the Gospel of John. Gospel means good news. It means the message of Jesus. So John is giving that to us. Now, what's interesting about the Gospel of John, and we got John himself, is that John is the only disciple who stayed with Jesus all the way till the end. When Jesus went to the cross, the other disciples, well, they deserted him. They left him, but John stayed until the end. And in John's Gospel, there are 21 chapters, and John spends almost half the book focused on 1 week of Jesus' life. Which is wild when you think about it. Jesus lived 33 years and John's going to spend 40% of the book focused on 1 week. And the reason John does that is because what happened in that week leading up to the death, burial, and resurrection, in the death, burial, and resurrection, that is the reason that Jesus came. That's the purpose that Jesus came. And John is focusing in, he's dialing in, he's zooming in on what happened there on the cross and the resurrection. Because he's saying this changes everything. He tells us why he wrote the book. He tells us the purpose of writing in chapter 20, verse 31, but let's read 30 and 31. It says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of these disciples, of his disciples, which were not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe, that you may what? May believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. I want you to underline, if you got a Bible, underline believe. I want you to underline believe because it's such an important word in the Gospel. If you don't have a Bible, you just underline it in the person next to you. Underline their Bible. Like, believe. That word is so important in the Gospel of John. It shows up in the New Testament 250 times, but in John's Gospel, it shows John 100 times. He's just like, this is it, that you would believe. What does that word believe mean? It means to trust. In the same way that you would trust a map, he's saying you can trust this, that it's accurate. But beyond that, he's saying that you would trust in the same way that, like, we would trust a chair. Like, you made a decision, no matter where you're sitting today, within the room and the overflow, you made a decision to sit in that chair. I don't know how long you evaluated that decision, but there came a moment of decision time where you put everything you are in that chair and you trusted that it will hold you. And John is saying, I'm giving you this so that you would trust, so that you would entrust. But to believe also means to entrust, in the same way that when the kids were little, Rhea and I were very careful who we left them with. We wouldn't just leave them with anybody. We wanted to know, are they credible? Are they trustworthy? Are they worthy of our trust to leave someone who is valuable to us? And John is saying, Jesus is, he is worthy of you to entrust. Entrust what? Entrust your life. Your everything, your hopes, your dreams, your future, your eternity, your present, your circumstances, your family, your work, everything, that you would entrust everything to him. He is trustworthy. I know there are people who have let you down. There are people who have disappointed. And John is saying, you can entrust Jesus with everything. We wouldn't diversify our ultimate trust, but that we would entrust, that we would believe on him. That's why he's writing us this book, that he is the Christ, that he is the Son of God, that by believing in him, we would have life. Well, how do we know? John says the signs. Now, there are a lot of signs in the Gospel of John, but specifically in chapter 20, he's saying the signs that were mentioned there. The third day, the stone rolled away, the empty tomb, the grave closed, the eyewitnesses, the conversations. We talked with him. We touched his hands and his side. John's saying all of these signs point to the resurrection. All of these signs point to the ultimate sign, which is the resurrection. The resurrection is the ultimate sign that Jesus is the Messiah, that Jesus is the Son of God, that he is God the Son, that he is worthy of our trust. The resurrection is the ultimate sign because without the resurrection, there is no Christianity. The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17, it says, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. He's saying, if there's no resurrection, we're lost. We don't have hope. There's no Savior. There's no salvation. There's no forgiveness of sin. There's no hope of eternal life. Yaroslav Pelikan, who was a professor at Yale, he phrased it this way. He said, if Christ is risen, nothing else matters. And if Christ is not risen, nothing else matters. He's saying if Christ has not raised from the dead, this is all meaningless. But if Jesus is raised from the dead, this is meaningless compared to his matchless glory, and he is worthy of all of the aim of our life and of our affection, of our attention, that we would worship him. He is worthy to hold us, not just for eternity, but in our life here. We can trust him. The resurrection is the ultimate sign. Let me tell you about the day I became a believer. October 20th, 2023. Some of you are doing the math. You're like, hold up, Pastor. Now, the day that I became a believer in Jesus, the day that he changed my life, was 30 years ago tomorrow. That was a great day. The other day that I became a believer was October 20th, 2023. Durham's team was playing another team that will go unnamed because that team is in a community where we have a campus. And I'm not trying to throw shade on Easter, but they were playing this other team that was undefeated. And I got asked to work the chains, you know, the yardage markers on the, they call it the chain gang, you know, on the visitor side to hold the yardage markers. And so I said, because it's the best seat in the house. I mean, it is the best seat to get to watch my son play. And so I'm standing out there and you can't cheer because you're a part of the officiating crew. So you can't cheer for your team, especially when some coaches and players on the other team are like, Pastor Kevin. So now I'm Pastor Kevin, kind of hiding behind the yardage marker and hoping things don't come down to a play where I have to, you know, make a lot of enemies of where I have to measure. So I'm out there and I'm just like, man, watch it. And y'all, I am about to explode on the inside because we're winning. Let me remind you, we were 0-22 and we're winning this game. And I'm just watching the clock tick down, and the clock ticks down to zero, and we win. 21-7. Y'all, I threw the yardage marker up in the air, and I run out to the field, and the whole town runs out to the field. Anybody who's ever lived in that town ran out to the field. Everybody runs to the field, and it is a celebration. I got a picture. This is us. Those are the biggest smiles we've had on a Friday night in years. And so we are celebrating. It was a celebration. Cheerleaders are crying, and moms and dads are hugging. People are FaceTiming relatives. It was incredible. Fathers are throwing small children in the air like confetti. I mean, it was a party. And the students begin, everybody gets on the 50 yard line and says, I believe that we just won. I believe that we just won. I believe that. And I jumped in like I chanted it too. I believe that we just won. I believe that's the day I became a believer, after we won. You're like, well, yeah, Pastor, of course you became a believer after you won. Yeah. This is what John is doing. I'm telling you, we just won. I've seen the resurrected Christ. He said, you don't have to check your brains at the door. You don't have to leave logic behind. I'm giving you the signs. I'm letting you know. John is using the technology of the day to let us know what happened. If you came to me and you're like, I'm not sure Durham's team won, I'd be like, I was there. Come with me. Come see. And I would give you all the signs that I could. But ultimately, it would be a choice that you make. John's saying, I want you to make the choice that won't just change your life here on earth. It'll change you forever. So he gives us the signs. We have reason to believe Lee Strobel, who was a reporter for the Chicago Tribune, an investigative reporter. And he studied as a lawyer, and he ends up, his wife became a follower of Jesus, and he wanted to dismantle her faith and dismantle Christianity. So he set out to do a piece on Christianity that would dismantle it, and he ends up becoming a believer. He ends up putting his faith in Jesus, and so he goes from a professed atheist to an apologist now who writes books on why there is credible reason to believe. He wrote a book called Case for Christ. If you've never read it, it's a great read. And in that book, he gives, and in some of his other books, he gives reason for the resurrection. Compelling reasons, and there are a lot of them, but I just want to give you four, and I want us to look at four reasons to believe in the resurrection, the ultimate sign. The first is the execution. You can't have a resurrection without a crucifixion, without the execution. And it is well documented among historians, even historians who lived at the time of Christ, and widely accepted by scholars today, that Jesus of Nazareth was crucified in Jerusalem. And John is one of the disciples. John gives us specific details that line up with other crucifixions and the ways that it happened. And John gives us those details because he was there. He tells us he was tried by Pontius Pilate. He was mocked and he was beaten by Roman soldiers. They gambled for his garments. He was flogged and they drove nails into his feet and hands, and he was hung on a tree. They put a sign above his head that said, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." His final words were, "It is finished." Here's what he's saying. He's like, the sacrifice for our sin, the final sacrifice, the perfect sacrifice for our sin so that we could be forgiven. It is finished. We can't earn God's love. We can't earn his forgiveness. Jesus has given it to us by grace. He said, it is finished. His final words, and the centurion, the soldier, took a spear and jabbed it in his side. John gives us all those details because he was there. In John chapter 19, verse 35, it says, "The man who saw this has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe." John's saying, I was there. I'm giving you all of this. I'm telling you all this because I saw it happen. I saw him die. I saw him on the cross and the execution. And second, the early reports. The resurrection was not a myth or a legend that was added later on. Like, the news of the resurrection, it spread quickly. It spread fast. It went wide. Shows up in early creeds in the church. It shows up in early documents about the resurrection. One of the most compelling for me is how worship went from Saturday to Sunday. For the early church, worship went from Saturday to Sunday. These were Jewish people who, for their entire lives, for 1,500 years, for generations, had worshiped on Shabbat, on Saturday. But something happened, and I think we minimize the significance of how hard it would be to make that change and why they would make that change from Saturday to Sunday. I mean, I've worked at churches where we couldn't get people to agree to change the carpet. And they changed. They went from, what would lead that made it that change from Saturday, which their families and for generations had to worship on Sunday, which they called the Lord's Day. It's the resurrection. And so you have these early reports, and then you have the empty tomb. Mary Magdalene, she comes to the tomb to prepare the body for a proper burial because things happen so fast on Friday, and then Saturday, Shabbat. And now Sunday, she goes to give a proper burial, and when she arrives, she sees that the tomb is empty, that the stone is rolled away. She doesn't know what's happened, so she goes and grabs the disciples, goes and tells them they're locked up in a room because they're afraid because Rome's got more crosses. And so they're hiding. And she goes and she tells them, and so they can't travel all 12 of them, so they send two of them there. In verse 3, it tells us, "So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed." Now, who is the other disciple? You know what that, like, other disciple. Like, who is the other disciple? It's John. This is the most humble brag ever. John's like, "We were racing and I won." He's like, "I know Peter went into the tomb first, but can I just, like, I beat him in a foot race." And then John said, "And I went in and he saw that the grave clothes were there. And if somebody stole the body, they're not gonna leave the grave clothes behind." And so John, that's all it took for him in that moment. He saw the grave clothes there, and he said, "I saw and I believed. I investigated, I looked, and I believed. The tomb is empty." This is a well-known tomb that people would have known where it was, a garden tomb, and it was empty. This is what separates Christianity from every other man-made religion in the world, is that there is a tomb that is empty. Every other religion has a founder with a tomb with a body in it. Buddha, tomb, body in it. Muhammad, tomb, body in it. Abraham, tomb, body in it. In Jerusalem, there is a tomb, and people travel from all over the world to go there to see. I'm going to save you some airfare. It's empty. And the stone was rolled away by the angel, not so that Jesus could get out, but so that the world could look in and see that he is alive, just as he said. You got an empty tomb, but it doesn't stop there. You have the eyewitnesses. After he was resurrected, you have the eyewitnesses. We read about it in verse 19. It says, on the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for the fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, boo. I'm just kidding. He didn't say that. But if I was Jesus in that moment, if they deserted me and they left me the moment I needed them most, I'm at least going to get a good scare. Aren't you glad that Jesus loves you more than anybody else? He didn't scare them. He didn't give them a piece of his mind. He gave them peace. He could see their fear. He spoke to their fear. He speaks to your fear today, and he gives you peace. Maybe you have a fear of death. Maybe you have a fear, and there's just so much uncertainty. He wants to give you faith to believe that you can trust him. He says, peace. He gives his peace to them. He extends peace to them. And it says, after this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. I bet they were. They were overjoyed. Joy is a byproduct of belief, of trust. So they saw him and they're overjoyed. And Jesus hangs out with them. It even says later on that he goes, like he eats with them. He shows them his hands and his sides. Over the next 40 days, there are 500 eyewitnesses who see Jesus. My favorite out of the 500 is James. I find this most compelling. James is the half-brother of Jesus, who did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah during Jesus' ministry years. Which I get. Can you imagine your sibling claiming to be the Son of God? James like, I don't know. Even though Jesus was perfect, James, but can you imagine the sibling rivalry going on there? Mary like, James, why can't you be more like Jesus? Is it because of Jesus? So there was all kind of just baggage that was going on there. And James goes from being an unbeliever to church history tells us that he was the leader at the church in Jerusalem. Goes on to author a book in the New Testament. Goes on to become a martyr. They threw him off the temple for his faith in Christ. Lays down his life. In his book, he calls Jesus Lord, which means master. Worship him. What would cause James to go from unbeliever to worship him? He said, I saw him. I saw him die. I saw him raise again. I believe. You're like, do you believe that Jesus is raised? Yes, I believe. I believe the eyewitnesses who saw it. I believe these disciples who they were so afraid, they locked themselves in a room because they were afraid of what would happen to them. But then they saw the resurrected Christ and they found this courage. They found this belief. They received the Spirit of God. And they were like, well, we want to tell everybody. They risked their lives to tell. They went from doors locked and a fear to giving their lives to spread this good news message that everyone would know that Jesus is who he said he was and that he can be trusted. Jesus even told him, he's like, hey, he told him throughout his ministry, multiple times, he's like, I'm gonna be crucified in Jerusalem. They're gonna put me in the tomb and 3 days later, I'm gonna be raised from the dead. Now we go crazy in sports when somebody calls their shot and when somebody's like, three, we lose our minds. Jesus called his own resurrection. Like, I don't know who you're trusting for your map, but I'm going with the person who called their own resurrection and made good on it, who said that they were going to get how they were going to lay down their life, and then was raised from the dead. And here's what the resurrection does. It validates everything else he said. It validates all of his teaching, that he's right. That he's right about God, and he's right about the world, and he's right about forgiveness, and he's right about relationships, and he's right about family, and he's right about justice, and he's right about grace, and he's right about sex, and he's right about heaven, and he's right about hell, and he's right about the good life, and he's right about eternal life. He's right about everything. Here's the good news. You can trust him. That we don't have to go through life without a map or with pieces of maps that we've put together. We can trust Jesus. We can trust that he's right. We can trust that he's right. In John 3:16, when he said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." Not whoever behaves, but whoever believes. Because you can't behave your way into heaven. You can't earn your way into heaven. You can't give your way into heaven. You can't philosophize your way into heaven. I don't even know if that's a word, but you can't do that into heaven. You believe your way into heaven. You believe your way into Christ. You believe in Christ, and that's a choice that you make. And it doesn't mean that you have everything figured out. It just means you put your faith in a person because you're putting your trust in someone. And maybe for a long time, you've put your trust in yourself. And you look around and you see where you're at in life and you realize, that's not it. I can't save myself. They write books that are called self-help books. And I look at that section, there's some okay books there, but I realize I need more than self-help. Because self is the one who got me in this mess to begin with. I need a savior. I need forgiveness. I need grace. And Jesus said, "Believe in me and I'll give you eternal life." And eternal life is not about the hereafter only. It's about the here and now. That he would give us life now. Well, how do you have that? Believe. In the moment you put your faith in Jesus, he tells us that he gives us his spirit to come live in us. Jesus said, he's the map. In John 14, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." He's not saying that I am a map. He's like, I'm the map. I'm not a way, I'm the way. And you know the only thing better than a map? It's a guide. It's somebody who knows their way around. Jesus is like, I know my way around life. I'm the only one to do it perfect. You'd be amazed at what he can do with yours. Will you trust me? Matthew trusted him, so I believe. Mark, I believe. Luke, I believe. John, I believe. Justin, I believe. You're like, who's Justin? Was he from Galilee? No, he's from East Nashville. I want you to get a chance to hear his story. Check us out.
I came to Nashville when I was 17 years old. I quickly found what I called a family group in the songwriting community. So I stuck around, went to Belmont, and the rest is history. I've been here for 21 years and been doing music for all of it. 5 years ago, I had come to CrossPoint on a random Sunday. I wasn't really into church a lot. And I walked in and just started crying. I knew it was the Holy Spirit, like, trying to tell me, hey, you know, it was tugging at my heart, you know. Little did I know that it was going to take 5 years of a journey of the Lord working on breaking down walls that I had built up. During that 5 years, as I pulled away from the church, I pulled away from God, I just kind of started going down the wrong path and actually became addicted pretty hard to some drugs and alcohol and really pride, because I don't know. I guess I was just had a lot of fear, a lot of shame, a lot of pride. I had a friend that started a thing called Music Row Ministries. It was a Bible study on Music Row. out of the blue. I was like, all right, I'm gonna come. I walked into the Bible study and the entire thing was all about baptism. Like he knew the exact way it had to happen for me and my soul. When I got asked, do I believe that God sent his son down here to die for my sins and that he was risen on the third day? When I was asked if he was my savior, I said, yes, I do believe. And in that moment, I got saved. And then I got baptized right after. I almost was sad that it took me 38 years as a human being to learn that I could have had this the whole time. I could have felt joy, which is not happiness. Happiness holds no candle to joy. Joy you only get from Jesus Christ. And I'm full of joy. You don't have to have a terrible story. They're all beautiful stories because they're all the same story. I once was lost and now I'm found.
What about you? What's your story? Have you ever had that moment that you put your faith and trust in Jesus? How does it happen? It tells us in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You will be saved. It's through belief. Well, how do we have a moment like that? It can start with a prayer. It begins with a prayer of putting your faith and your trust in Jesus. I'd love to lead you in a prayer like that. And a prayer like that doesn't mean that all the doubts and questions go away. It means that you have someone to bring your doubts and your questions to who loves you. And Jesus said, you'll be in the Father's grip and nothing can snatch you from the Father's grip. That's the offer this Easter. Easter 2024 can change your life and your eternity forever. What will you do with the offer of God? I'd love to lead you in a prayer to say yes to him. Would you bow your heads and your hearts with me? If you've never trusted in Jesus, you need to know God loves you. His heart is that you would believe. And it starts with a prayer. You pray something like this. You can just whisper it after me. Father, thank you for loving me. I believe that you gave your son for me. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sin. And I believe he was raised from the dead. So right now, I lay down my old maps. I give you my old life. I ask for forgiveness for my sin, and I receive the promise of new life. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for making me new. I want to live for you here on earth, and the promise I will live with you forever in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. The Bible tells us when even one person prays a prayer like that, repents, turns to the Father, all of heaven breaks out in a party. Can we just celebrate those who have made that decision today? We're so proud of you. I want to ask something of all of us. This would be a moment where we would be able to take a snapshot of where we are as a church, as a gathering together, and give you a way to respond. There was a card that was on your seat when you came in, and I want to encourage you, get this in your hands, and there's a pen there for you to write as well. We would love for you to tell us where you are in your faith journey. So just so that we're able to see where we're at, it helps us in planning, helps us look forward as a church, also helps us know how to respond to you, and that you would circle where you are today. Let me walk through these A, B, C, D. A means I'm already a follower of Jesus. I was already a follower of Jesus before I came in. B means I'm believing in Jesus for the first time today. If you made that your prayer for the first time today, you can indicate that there. C means I'd like to consider it and I'd like to know more. Spiritually curious, like to find out more. D means I don't intend on making that decision. If that's where you're at, let us know that. Then put whatever information you feel comfortable sharing with us. It'd be helpful for us to follow up and encourage you. And then we'll collect these on the way out today. So we're going to give you a moment to fill this out. Ask that everybody would do that and that you would drop this off on the way out today. And then we have a chance for us to worship and to make the declaration of our belief, which for generations as followers of Jesus and across the nations around the world, that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the Son of the living God. We can worship together.